screwing up three intros later.
I know. And we are live, folks. Welcome to the Sit Down Standard, the podcast celebrating all the amazing things you could do while sitting, whether it's enjoying movies, watching television, or playing games. I'm one of your hosts, David Bram, joined as always by Gerald Bales.
Hi.
The texting Gerald Bales. And Jordan Peterson.
That's a Mr. Jordan Peterson to you.
How are you, buddy?
Like the 40th time.
Eventually,
I didn't make all of them. It's like 32.
32 out of 41.
Yeah, it's pretty good.
Exactly. Now, if you guys are listening, of course, to the audio version. Oh, bless you. Good Lord. On camera and everything.
Excuse me.
See, this is why you should be checking out the video version. If you're just listening to audio, that just
Oh, you
like...
heard that. You heard it.
No, but you can go to youtube.com/sitdownstandard. You can see all of our beautiful faces, as well as all the great other stuff that we do on the video podcast. You can also follow us on Instagram, Twitter, and on Facebook. It's at Sit Down Standard. But before we move on, because we just got done watching the X-Men, is it just called X-Men Apocalypse?
Yes.
Okay, well, we're gonna get into that, but before we get there, we want to talk about the contest that's currently ongoing. It's called June for St. Jude's. It's where we're actually encouraging folks to donate to the... You okay?
You are sniffing, man.
Okay,
we're good.
You're okay. Yeah,
we're
just checking if you're all right. We're encouraging folks to donate to the Children's Hospital. Basically, if you donate at least $5 to stjude.org/donate, and then to post a photo of your donation to your basically social media, Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, with hashtag SDS giveaway, that puts you into the contest to win. Or you can simply email us a copy of your donation, your photo, to sitdownstandard@gmail.com.
Sitdownstandard@gmail.com.
And then, of course, that puts you in the contest. Now, we've already actually announced two waves of prizes. We give all this great stuff.
Back to those shows. Yeah, there's so many prizes.
We have Bose headphones. We have a ton of great games. We have X-Men inspired gifts. We have the Dice Masters, right?
That's amazing, right.
Spider-Man. I think there's some X-Men in that even Amazing Spider-Man set.
I'm sure.
Lots of good stuff. But we're going to announce just a few more here. So we're going to get into it right now. So... Oh, first things first. Some limitations. We always got to apologize to all of the U.S. territories.
I can't think of any more territories.
Okay.
Well, it's just Puerto Rico and the Virgin Islands.
Can't we just apologize to other countries?
Here we go.
Hold on.
Canada, we're sorry, Canada.
American Samoa.
It's limited to one entry per person, and it's only the continental U.S. You have to be a continental U.S. resident to be actually a part of it. But we've had a bunch of people donating. It's awesome. I get so excited every time someone donates and puts it on their Instagram or Twitter. I'm so pumped.
What if I was a resident of the continental United States, but I was visiting like an embassy in like Britain?
As long as your mailing address is within the continental
yeah,
U.S.
There you
I'm
go.
Just saying,
sorry, Alaskans.
Okay, so we're
pretty gonna... much Russia at this point. You're close enough.
According to Sarah Palin.
Okay. I can see him from across the thing.
Okay, let's start off talking. We've got some more prizes to announce. The first one is the Yellow Games bundle. They gave us a couple games to give away. Here, I've got them right here.
Oh,
this is actually pretty. See, this is why you should check out the video podcast. The first game is called Loot and Run. That's the one on your left. This is kind of a press your luck where you're going into the dungeon and you can keep going further.
No whammy.
Exactly. No whammy. Stop. But what's actually cool, it's got a lot of cool player interaction. So you keep getting cards, and the more cards you get, they might have a monster on it or some treasure, and other people can call you out. And if they catch you with a monster, you're screwed. But if you waste their turn, you waste your turn if they're not caught with a monster. So very, very cool game. Very light, but also gives enough strategy for people that are gamers. So you can kind of play it with everybody. The other one is...
This is my kind of game right here. Njet.
Njet, because of course...
I got some hammer and sickle cards on here. Perfect.
This is a trick-taking game from Yellow Games. One of the best... I've actually heard nothing but great reviews about this game. I haven't had a chance to play it, but I definitely want to check it out just from the artwork alone. It's got this cool...
Your prize may come open. I'm just kidding. We're not going to open.
This is it's got that USSR inspired Soviet Russia, very cool.
For the motherland.
So those are that's the Yellow Games bundle. We want to give them a big thank you. Of course, we want to thank everybody who donated gifts and donations for us to give away during the contest. But you can check out more of their great games at yellowgames.com, and that's spelled a little different. It's I-E-L-L-O.
Not like yellow the color, like yellow the way they spell it, yellow.
Yeah, exactly. So that's a Yellow Games bundle. So thank you. Okay, next bundle is from Breaking Games. Nope, the one on your right. You're already messing up here.
All right.
Breaking Games is giving us a bundle, the Breaking Games bundle. There's two games here. There is Letter Tycoon. Now, normally I'm not a huge fan of like word games like Scrabble and Words with Friends.
How do you not like Scrabble?
I'm not a big fan of Scrabble.
Because you don't know big words?
I don't. I'm not a good... I don't speak good. but this game is really unique. It essentially takes spelling, which is like Scrabble and all that stuff, but you get money for spelling longer words and more difficult words, and then you can use that money to buy stock in a letter. So if anybody uses that letter later on, you get paid on it. But then they also know, like, certain letters. No, but this
like
is
a way to make a normal, boring letter game probably even more frustrating and boring.
No. This one's really cool because even takes, like, letters like that you normally wouldn't use, like Z's and Q's, and gives them special abilities. So it even incentivizes you to buy letters that you might not, people might not use very often. Very well, cool artwork style. I like the
cool Zeppelin.
Yeah, it's got that
token
cool
in here, yeah.
So that's Letter Tycoon. You're gonna win a copy of that, as well as Poop the Game, the brown bag special. poop in a bag.
You light it on fire and put it in front of someone's
and
house.
Just say surprise your friends with hashtag poop in a bag by ordering from poopthegame.com.
So wow. So you can win
freshness guaranteed.
It's a highbrow.
Very highbrow.
Oh yeah, that's a fresh one.
So you can win Letter Tycoon and Poop in a Bag.
So like, it's funny, they're by the same people,
same company.
I feel like they have two totally different audiences.
There you go. Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
High level, like, market, super spectrum. Poop in a Bag. The whole demographics covering these two
you
games.
You will find something you enjoy with this package. I guarantee it, because you're one of those two groups. I promise you.
So you can check out more of their great games. It's at breakinggames.com. So we want to, of course, thank them as well. All right. Got a couple more bundles here. The next one is from Game Right Games. They gave us all three of those. Yes. Even grab the third one there.
I have two hands.
Okay.
Two hands. I will grab the third one.
Oh, come on, Jordan.
I get a chance.
You're supposed to use your tail there like Nightcrawler.
Spoilers.
Here we go. They gave us three games, actually, as a bundle, so you're going to win all three. One is Dragonwood. The artwork in this is really cool.
Yeah, I really want to play Dragonwood.
Yeah.
All they need to do to sell a game is put the word dragon in the title, and I'm like, wood. Oh, sounds good.
How do you not like Game of Thrones?
I would like
that. Got dragons and wood in it.
I can't get to the dragon.
Jeez. Okay. Right? Dragonwoods is basically kind of another pressure luck game, but you use like cards, like different colored cards and numbered cards to create straights. Set collecting, but you can do a couple different things when you go out on quests. You can fight monsters using like you know, melee, or you can shout at them to scare them to death, apparently. Very cool. It's a good game for families, so it allows you to... basically, younger kids could also play this and enjoy it, but it still has enough strategy in it. The next one is Sushi Go, which we're all fans of. I've had a chance to play this. I love this game. Very simple set collection drafting mechanic. So you take a card, you pass the bundle, you take a card, pass the bundle. We've done that with like Magic the Gathering tournaments where you do the drafting. So very great artwork, of course. It's got sushi in it, so always a good thing. Do you like sushi, Jordan?
I love sushi.
Okay,
so good.
But I like to eat it.
Well, you can eat this while you play it. There you go. Yeah. It'll inspire you to go out to your local sushi bar. The last one is
Batman. The Bat.
I'm Batman.
This is Roy Story Cubes. This is the Batman edition. Roy Story Cubes, very popular. Great with kids, great with adults. And, of course, it's got Batman. So you can't go wrong there unless he's versed in Superman.
Look at that grin on Joker. Holy crap. Look at those teeth.
Yeah, so some awesome artwork on the dice. So you got
frightening.
These
frightening
like stick guy running away.
So custom dice there. So that is the Game Rights game bundle. So we, of course, want to thank them. You can check out all their great games. We've played one of their games, Forbidden Desert. You guys like
that? Yeah, oh, God, that game is punishing.
So, really hard game.
GameRight.com. You can find out all their great games, including Forbidden Desert, as well as all the ones we talked about here today. Okay, so that's the third one. This is the last one for this week. Of course, like I said, we've got lots of other ones. You should check out our earlier episodes. Last two episodes, we talked about a ton more. But this is from USopoly. You've had a chance to check out this game. It's Telestrations. It's
the game's great.
Yes, Telestration. It's the 6-player family pack, so you can play 4 to 6 players. What? You give it like the AO?
No, it's a great game.
No, it basically is Pictionary, but you have like
telephone
part of it. So I draw something, I get a clue and I draw something, and then I pass that to the next person and they have to guess what word it was based off the drawing. And then that word goes to the next person who draws something. So you see how far along in the telephone game.
After playing this with a few family members, it can
break up some relationships.
Oh yeah.
It was awesome. But by the end of it, it's just fun to flip through the book to be like, what? Yeah. Where did you get that?
And to me, there isn't really like scoring involved.
There is. You can keep points, but
it's more fun just to be like, what the heck?
Yeah, there's lots of great stuff. And again, this is one of those games where anybody can play. It's a great party game, and it's got that small barrier of entry. We always talk about that.
Great drink.
Drink, everyone, barrier of entry. So again, great, great game, Telestrations. USopoly, they actually make a lot of the variants of Monopoly, like your Zelda version of Monopoly.
Of the official Monopoly?
Yeah, yeah. Well, the Zelda version that you have. That official Zelda Monopoly, yeah. That you can get those, all those, they have all of them.
I have Pugopoly. Do they have that?
I don't know. But you can check out all their great games at usopoly.com. So, of course, we want to thank them. And then, again, all you need to do, what is it? At least $5?
At least. Come on, guys. These are kids.
To stjude.org/donate. So, very simple. Do it right now. Just stop.
Pause. Stop it right now.
Go donate it. Put it on your Instagram with hashtag SDS giveaway or Twitter or Facebook. We'll find you. I'll make sure to find you.
We'll find you.
Jesus.
And then that'll put you in the pool. Now it's going to run till the end of June. So you have till the end of June to submit your donation photo. And then we're going to be announcing winners on July 4th. But again, it's limited to only U.S. continental residents and only one entry per person.
Yes.
Unless you make a whole bunch. But if you're donating $5, hey, whatever.
At least $5.
At least $5. Okay. So now that we've gotten through all the great donation stuff, let's talk about what we're here
X-Men.
For. We just saw X-Men.
Days of Futures Past. Oh, wait. So many freaking X-Men movies.
We just saw X-Men Apocalypse, hence the figure on the table here. Yeah. Move this back a little bit.
The more medicine figure than Oscar Isaac and blue paint.
Okay, so let's first do, because we always kind of do this, we'll do a normal non-spoiler review of what we thought, and then we'll go into full spoiler territory and we'll warn everybody. Okay. So first things first. What did you guys think?
Are we going to do the standard
review? Yeah, let's do it. Let's do it. Yeah. Standard review. So thumbs up is a great movie. Thumbs to the side is a good movie. And thumbs down is a bad movie. 1, 2, 3. Yeah, all the same.
All right. It was all good
movie. All to the side. So all of us thought it was a good movie, not a great movie. And
That great movie. I mean, it's got to be great.
Well, we'll talk about this, but where do you guys, in further detail, but where does it fall in the pantheon of the X-Men movies? I mean, what's the best one?
How many of them are in those?
Eight. No, this is the eighth.
Are you counting the Wolverine movies?
Yeah, so there's three, the original three, then the two Wolverines. Then you have Days of Future Past, First Class. This is the eighth one.
Okay, wow.
Deadpool technically is in the universe, but I'm not going to count that as an X-Men movie.
I would barely even count the Wolverine. So
it's all canon.
Yeah, the Wolverine movies are canon to this universe. I don't think.
Hey,
Deadpool,
buddy, you're the X-Men
canon.
Guy. You're supposed to care.
No, I'm just saying they're not like. I mean, Wolverine. So side
I mean, X-Men 3:
really
The
X-Men.
Last Stand, obviously my favorite.
No, yeah, of course.
Yeah, I was like, that's.
They did make a kind of joke in the movie.
They make some. Don't spoil it. That's a great joke in the movie. Don't spoil that. But there's some. They make some internal jokes about all the meta stuff. But I think for me, this movie kind of falls below, First Class and Days of Future Past. It's probably lower than even X2. I think that's probably the best of the original three.
What? Do you know, like, the first one? I like
the first one's
really good.
I haven't seen it.
It sets the stage just for superhero movies in general.
Yeah.
Spider-Man were like setting the bar.
For sure.
But I still think it's better than that first one, just from I haven't watched it in a long time. But the thing about this movie that was, it's a great popcorn movie. Does that make sense?
It's a very fun movie.
It's a fun movie. Like, it doesn't take itself too serious.
Don't think too much about it. Just go in, get a thing of popcorn, get a Coke.
But the bigger
Pepsi Cola.
Yeah, the big thing that I had a problem with is it's paint by numbers. I mean, there's not a lot of like twists and turns.
Everything that happened in the movie in like the later act, the climax, you saw it coming from a mile away.
Yeah, but it's still an enjoyable romp through the X-Men universe.
There's some
nerd service. I always enjoy, we talk about this, so I always enjoy seeing the characters learn their powers in unique and fun ways. Those are always cool, and they do that in this movie.
Yeah, kind of.
When?
With Cyclops and different things like that. Yeah. So there's some cool stuff with that. It's also interesting that they kind of, you know, the one thing about X-Men and just Marvel in general, everybody's everybody's brother, sister, mother, daughter.
Right.
And they actually do a good job of balancing that without it being like forced, you know, hamstrung. You know what I mean? Like everyone's, you know, they're all connected because it's like, you know, mutant gene follows. Remember they talked about that in one of the earlier movies. But the special effects, I actually liked Apocalypse. All things aside, I enjoyed the character.
His nose bothered me a little bit. I don't know why.
Oh, the actual, like,
his
makeup?
His nose just looked too big.
He does not look like Poe Dameron, man. They did a good job. Yeah. At no point was I like, that's Oscar Isaac.
Yeah, obviously the very beginning where he's naked, that part. And then there's a couple of scenes where I'm like, okay, I could see Oscar Isaac. But yeah, generally, you don't really see him. A lot of prosthetics and paint.
I would say some of these new mutants that are, you know, featured in this movie, well, not new, but some that are younger versions, well, they're all younger versions, but just some of the mutants as far as the ones that are you want to see, they kind of don't, you don't get to see them. This movie is chock full of characters that you know, but you don't know this version of it. Which is frustrating.
I felt like they left a lot of unused. I don't want to spoil it too much, but
yeah,
the favorite character I was looking forward to seeing, like they just
they kind of gloss over anything, stuff. Yeah,
like, so, there's just too much in the movie to really dive into these characters, and it's unfortunate. But you know, what do you got to do?
So I think for me, I would definitely tell people go see it. I think it was definitely enjoyable. I think obviously with the mixed reviews that it's already gotten, you talked about this, the expectations were a little bit lowered, and I think that actually might have helped.
Around 51-52%
I think it's better than that for sure.
I think it is too.
I would give it like a solid B, a B plus even. As far as I think it's,
I mean, you're putting this on a scale of like all movies.
Like if you look at like Days of Future Past and stuff, that was way better to me.
Me too. But I would say those are like
First Class was way better.
That we talked about this. We're kind of tired of J-Law, Jennifer Lawrence.
Oh my God, Jennifer Lawrence. She was probably the worst part about this movie for me.
I actually don't mind her as a character, but it's because she's playing the same character in almost.
Stop leading young kids into battle. So overseen.
She even seemed over it, though.
No, her acting in the movie, she was phoning it in pretty much the whole time.
Yeah, she was just kind of like, okay.
Guys, we have to bet we're X-Men.
Yeah.
Okay?
It's pretty bad.
It didn't seem like she cared at all.
And so for me, I think it's interesting. There are some characters that, some people in this movie that steal the show, and they should have been featured more. I think we'll talk about that in more detail.
I mean, everyone, if you've seen Days of Future Past, you know Quicksilver.
He steals.
His scene, just like in Days of Future Past, steals the show in this movie.
So there's a lot of cool stuff they do. Like I said, a lot of the mutant powers are very cool. And, you know, this movie, more than maybe some other like X-Men movies, and maybe it's just because technology has advanced that far, you get to see like the superpowers, like in their superest power moments. You know what I mean? Like, it's not this... we're going to show you that one time and not really, and it's going to be real quick and you're not going to, it's going to look
gonna
cool.
Flash away from where the camera moves really fast. You know what I understand is you're right. The graphics look great for their superpower usage, but then like the graphics for like going around the tomb and like the opening credits and scenes and stuff. Looks
that's a callback to all the X-Men movies though.
I know, like, but I do it in such a, it reminds me of like the Aladdin scene where they're like flying away from the lava. Like it looks so bad. And I'm like, we're in 2016.
That's the
like,
title
why?
Crawl. Yeah.
Why
the opening title
so
crawl
bad?
Is so bad.
I didn't mean that, or I didn't mind that, just because it is a callback to all the other. It had the stupid Cerebro door closed. I'm like, oh, it's an X-Men movie.
That's the only
okay.
part that looked good was the Cerebro door. I don't know. It just looks bad. There were several parts in the movie. Whenever they do that, like the camera's moving deep into something and going around,
it
just looks horrible. It's like, why? It doesn't need to look horrible. Like, spend a little bit more money. Like, fix that. Get somebody.
And it's at the very beginning of your movie. I will say the one thing. Speaking of callbacks, I think this movie started to bother me with the amount of callbacks and the amount of used footage from the original or the older movies.
Oh, yeah.
I was like, we get it.
Yeah,
like, we know about it. Like, you know what I mean?
Especially
like, there's a whole bunch of stuff where it's just like, stop going back, and you don't have to re-record it or show something in between. That would have been interesting. Some kind of interaction between those last movies and this current movie. Don't just show me footage from your old movies. That probably accounted, I want to know, I want to, if you added it up, maybe like 10 minutes. I mean, I know that doesn't sound like a lot of time, but it's cut up and it's like, come on, dude.
Yeah.
Like, there's already so much we need to get to. Stop showing me old stuff. And I get that they've got to, you've got to be able to.
There's an audience out there that's never seen those movies.
Well, go see it. What are you doing?
Because they're like little kids when they came out. Not old enough for a PG-13.
But generally, I would say go see it. But it's not as good as the last two that came out.
For sure. Not as good.
Agreed. Yeah,
it has to do with a little bit of the villain. If you make them too powerful, it's always the villain. It's like,
we were talking about this in the car. It's like Ultron, you know.
Yeah.
You run into a problem when they're so powerful. The stakes kind of get lost in that. You're like...
Yeah, it was just too much. And then, I can't say anything without spoiling.
Yeah, we'll get to that right now. Okay, so that's our non-spoiler review.
Go see it. It's great.
Go see it. All right, now we're entering spoiler territory. You have been warned. If you have not seen the movie... Go watch it. Come back. Listen to our spoiler review. Let's get into it. Okay. Let's talk about... Let's just get the bad stuff out of the way, because I'm interested in talking about that.
Jennifer... Oh, we were talking about her.
No, but honestly, I think it's specifically that scene with... Almost at the end of the movie, where she's talking to them... First of all, like, one good thing. The danger room. Very cool.
That was cool.
Cool.
Yeah. See the sandals come out. I'm like, yeah. I asked him, like, oh, what was that room called? Because I remember seeing it in, like,
danger
the cartoons and stuff. Yeah.
Yeah. But she... That speech at the end was just brutal.
We're X-Men.
It's brutal. Yeah, just brutal. But she did... I mean, I get her... Maybe her character is kind of this, like, she talks about, like, I'm just fighting for me. Like, I don't really care. I'm not a hero.
And she does turn into a bad guy.
Right.
But it was kind of cool that she had the Mystique costume.
Yeah.
At the end. That was kind of cool.
Yeah, she had,
the skull, but yeah. Yeah, it's like the white and the blue.
What did you not like? What are some of the things that you didn't like?
I did not like, one, that Jubilee was not
completely
in the movie. Oh my god, in the trailer, I'm like, she's got the yellow jacket and everything.
What a complete tease.
Not do anything. Like, you did it exactly the same way they did it in X-Men 1. That was disappointing.
At least maybe she did fireworks in somebody's hand or something.
Yeah,
like
she
that.
Did it. I thought
she did the power.
I was like, oh, they're going to actually bring her into this, because she was a big deal about her jacket and all this stuff. I was excited to see Jubilee, even though Jubilee's a horrible character,
of course,
but it's fun because she can't do anything, but it's funny and like makes some blind somebody or
and
something.
She's not even
in the movie. I mean, you know it's her, but not her name's not mentioned.
It's weird because I saw scenes, maybe I'm forgetting, but I think I saw in the trailer a scene when they're in the mall. There is a scene in the mall and she's in it, but it's just so strange to waste that reveal and that tease for nothing. There's nothing. No gold at the end of that rainbow.
No, not at all.
And I wasn't even thinking that there was. You know what I mean? Like, my expectations were so low that all I just wanted to see was fireworks shoot out of her
hand. Time.
Yeah, or like she walks up to an arcade machine and she hits
blows it up.
Yeah, or something silly, but it's just complete wasted. It's just like,
I don't understand why. Like,
it's just a
fan service. That's what you should do.
I know.
I don't understand.
I was hoping she was going to get, you know, remember the intro? Da-na-na-na-na. She's up against the gate. I thought she was going to do that.
How great would that be?
I know. But they've already, this is, we talked about this on the drive home too. They're running out of X-Men stories. Like, honestly, like
the good ones.
Like the great staples. X-Men staples. They've done Apocalypse. They've done Days of Future Past. They've done the mutant registration thing. Like,
Logan is supposed to be the next Wolverine movie.
There's
the last
no way.
Wolverine
I read those. There's no way they could do Old Man Logan.
Yeah.
There's no way, because they don't own the properties to everything.
They're never like the exact. Look at Civil War.
Yeah, that's true. You know? I'm just saying, like, that Old Man Logan was all about like fighting like Hulk and fighting.
Yeah,
like,
they can't get.
That's what I'm saying. They'll figure something else out.
Just big green big guy.
But speaking of big reveals that were kind of ruined in the trailer, it shows Wolverine
his claws.
Man, that was such a cool scene in the movie. The reveal of Weapon X.
Yeah,
I wish they didn't show the claws during the trailer, man, because that was a cool reveal. They released Weapon X. He's so like ragging, obviously like more animalistic.
Yeah,
kind of like at the beginning of the first X-Men movie. Very cool. They kind of ruined it with the trailer, though. But
They show the claws.
Headset thing, like, it's cool because that's Weapon X, you know. But it did look kind of corny. It didn't look good.
No, yeah, it didn't
look good. They could have done a better headset thing. Like, I'm like, really? Like, sometimes I'm just like, really, guys? Like, who did you pass this by that said that's good? I don't know what that's about. Like, I'm happy to see Weapon X. It was a really cool scene. But yeah, they could have done a much better job with it. But yeah, I used to actually read all the like little Wolverine like novels when I was a kid.
Oh yeah,
being an animal and like and him like learning who he was and eventually going to Japan and that whole stuff.
So when she references like I've unlocked some memories of the past, what do we think she's talking
about?
Okay, so
this
is, I think she just gave him his name.
Like, no, I think she remember. Yeah, because this is the problem with time travel and all the Days of Future Past. So what exists and what doesn't? Because when he goes back in Days of Future Past, Wolverine, Halle Berry's there, Marston is there. Everyone.
I think he erases. I thought he just erases Last Stand.
Right, but this is the so
well,
she
the
gave
first
him,
three movies.
She gave him an. So this is the problem. I mean, I'm maybe she knows his name's Logan, right?
Well, she pulled it out of his head.
Right, Jean Grey. So when he shows up, why isn't she like, oh my god, you were that guy?
Well, she will. That hasn't happened.
I guess you're right. It's just the problem.
The first three movies don't exist in this timeline.
But they do, that the result of them happens. None of the first three movies happen?
No.
That's the same characters. Like you
I
said,
thought
they
just got rid
people.
Of X3.
No, because you can't do that. Unless you went to like that point after in between X2 and X3.
Yeah.
He wiped it from the end of the 70s.
I guess, you're right.
And then, so anything from that point on is going to be changed.
Yeah.
So, hopefully, they'll do another intro.
Just redo them. Why not?
What if they redid them exactly?
Yeah, exactly. That'd be fine.
So, at the end of Days of Futures Past, Stryker digs up Logan.
Yes.
Yeah.
Right?
Yes.
Because he's still
got he's
got
all the metal and crap in him.
Yeah.
But he's still got bone claws. But does he not have adamantium at that point?
No,
that's
the Weapon X.
Yeah,
the Weapon X program gave him the antimantium, whatever the hell you say that. But I loved that he was in it. It would have been great for them not to have revealed that. That was kind of a waste. Speaking of waste, Psylocke, complete waste. Like
just Psylocke, Angel, all the four horsemen other than Magneto.
Storm was the worst.
It's just
super cool character yeah. and everything. But
I love how she got her white hair.
Yeah.
Very cool to explain all that.
It was cool to charge because she's one of the most powerful. Actually, him and Magneto, you know, they're some of the most powerful mutants
right.
at all.
And I
it
like
made
the,
sense.
Did you
the
see the nod at the very
it.
End? They both look at each other like... Yeah,
yeah,
we're going to go at it one day.
Yeah,
like,
we
we're
are.
Both pretty powerful.
But they barely used Storm. I mean, she didn't do anything till the very end. Like, she didn't do
and
anything.
And Psylocke,
she
cut that car, but
that
was pretty much it. Had that stupid whip. That was dumb.
Psylocke, no. I actually thought they did a better job with her than any of the other horsemen.
But doesn't she have mind powers?
No, she can make
telepathic
blades.
Yeah. Weapons.
Oh, she has telepekinesis, I think, to a certain extent.
Yeah, I thought
but
she did, too.
But,
yeah, it's always
but,
swords.
But generally... First of all, just her outfit is ridiculous because it's like
it looks, it's pulled right out of the comics. Though.
I know it is,
it
was, but it's
yeah,
like
I
it looks.
It.
I do too, but it looks well. There's lots of reasons. Lovely Munn, come on. But it kind of looks ridiculous next to everybody else's because everyone else kind of has this more modern look to her to them. Even Storm, you know, because she had kind of like you know that goofy looking white cape with like the little you know, but she doesn't wear that. She wears a cool outfit, and then right. Psylocke's got this like leotard on. It just looks kind of striking when in a couple different ways.
In the beginning of the movie when Apocalypse is recruiting his four horsemen, I'm just like, this is so dumb. So like he goes up to somebody who's really powerful, I'm gonna make you even more powerful, give Storm white hair. Next time we've seen her, she's got this cool sick armor. It's like, oh, so is he like...
No,
but then they show later, he's building the armor. I'm like, okay, they explain it. Because I thought it was the dumbest thing. It's like, we're going to find you a nice suit of purple and blue armor. Let's go to a store.
Go to the superhero store.
Also, like, whose power were they using to just, like, walk through space and time?
That's Apocalypse.
He can do that?
Remember, yeah. he each mutant he takes the body of, he takes their power. So he has a crap ton of power.
Yeah, they just...
We don't even know.
Then, that's convenient.
Okay, remember, he has the power to move sand.
Sand, yeah. I think that's his power, is he controls sand.
Sandman. He's Sandman
from
Spider-Man 3. No, I did enjoy the beginning part. I actually liked the Apocalypse kind of
You see him all old in the same armor and stuff.
Yeah, that was kind of
cool.
I think they did as good as...
Some cool powers.
Yeah, they did.
Yeah.
I was like, let's go
Except
to that.
For like, okay, so the girl who wraps him in a cocoon to save him, right? I'm like, you had that power the whole time? Like, why wouldn't you start wrapping all your friends in cocoons, like, immediately?
Just
like,
protect
right
the...
away.
She's saving her power for, like, the guy.
And it should be like, you know, like in the airplane, they're like, fasten your own thing first, then do the child's. Like, wrap me in a cocoon, because I have the cocoon wrapping ability, and then wrap the others in cocoons, because I'm protected.
My thing is, like, he's like, I've been waiting.
Back then,
I've been waiting thousands of years to find someone as like psychic, right? But it's like we got two. There's Jean and Professor X. Like you couldn't find any other psychic person back then.
No,
that's his powers.
They didn't exist.
I did enjoy that part of the movie where it was kind of this using him as the conduit to get to Cerebro to basically his whole point
is
to be
hand-fisted in there though.
I actually enjoyed it. I liked it. It was omnipresent. You know, this the only thing he doesn't have is the ability to control everyone's mind. You know, like Professor X, like as much as I think in the movies, because he's a very, you know, he's an introverted character. He's not an aggressor.
Right.
You never see, you know, the full.
Yeah,
I think he can
just like kill everybody.
And like
he just explode their brains.
Yeah. Like, yeah. And that's what's you never see that. And I think this
Isn't
movie
that, wasn't the plot of X2 as well. Like, did they inject that stuff in the Cerebro?
Oh yeah. They were trying to like
they were trying
convince
to,
him to do stuff.
Yeah.
So, no, they were trying to convince him to find mutants, I think, so they could
kill or. Track
like,
them
now
down,
concentrate on the humans and like think about it and kill them. I think.
That's what Magneto was doing, trying to turn it.
Yeah.
But I liked that idea. If he's like, "Oh, you let me in," and of course, there's the reference later on where he's inside his head. But I think for Apocalypse, they did as good a job as they could. He looks similar.
No,
I mean, this
doesn't.
Is a pretty. No,
he's blue. He's not as a beefcakey as like the normal Apocalypse you'd think of, which kind of sucks.
No,
he's
at
not
the end,
like,
at the end, he when he's inside his Professor X's brain, he's kind of looks like.
But
that's
not
when
he's
not in
the
physical
form. Holding Jean and Cyclops right here.
Yeah,
he's
I know.
Not like that at all.
No, of course
Plus,
not.
He got no A on his belt. He needed the A on the belt.
Yeah, they went with the whole hieroglyphic stuff going on, which is cool. I liked you know, the sun is what provides him. He's like, I am raw. You know, like I liked all of that stuff. I enjoy kind of the mythos of Apocalypse.
Where did they get that technology back in the Egyptian times? Where you're gonna use the some beams and travels through fiber optics. And all. I'm just like,
yeah, I know, it's mutants,
and then the,
guys.
Yeah, and then
come
the
on.
Gold that would just like go. I was like, okay, I'm down with it all as it all flowed down. And then it just started flowing up. And I was
oh, but
like,
you don't mind the chick okay. that puts people in cocoons?
No, she's okay.
No, I get the superpowers, but it's like, does someone have the superpower of building this technology? The funny, super smart guy.
So the funny thing that I saw, the first word of this movie is like sticking it to Marvel Cinematic Universe. The very first word out of this movie is mutants. It's like right. you can't use it.
Enhanced individuals. Blah, blah, blah.
They're like mutants. Suck it. Okay, a couple things that I. Oh, do you have anything else you want to talk about that you didn't really enjoy? I think that's really probably, for me, that was pretty much it. I thought most of it was from there was pretty good. I thought Jennifer Lawrence was meh.
Angel was cool.
Should have been used more.
Yeah. Well, all those characters should have been used.
We want a six-hour movie.
Right. But I thought actually Angel was, I thought he was utilized pretty well.
But when he's like, I want to find the most powerful mutants, this guy can fly. Girl can make blades.
Yeah, but it made thematic sense in the idea that there's basically a bounty hunter that, well, he's not a bounty hunter, but he's tracking down powerful mutants to like get them out of, I guess, pay them mercenaries to make them free. Or I don't know what that guy's whole shtick was.
Yeah, that whole thing.
But at least that made sense. He was kind of an insider. He knew where mutants were. But it also kind of cuts against like your Apocalypse. Go find, like, figure it out. Like, you know what I mean? Like, it's always that problem with like the all powerful being. It's like, oh, you need someone else's help. Like, how powerful are you? But
okay, and one big negative thing. All right, Magneto, let's talk.
Okay, here we go.
Are you good or bad? Because every single one of these movies now, it's like he's bad. Now he's good. Now he's bad. He's so easily turned.
Yeah, he's got inner struggles.
Yeah, I guess. I'm just like, figure out, man, are you bad or are you good? But and I mean, I get they have to do that in these movies.
Well,
but
that's
it's
how
just,
they have
it's
to
the
do
same
it.
Thing in every movie. It's
I betrayed
annoying.
Them.
The story behind him is him and Professor X were friends, and then they had a different looks at ideals and stuff, and they split.
Yeah, but then they're bad. Then he's bad. Not like flip-flopping.
Yeah, but they join up to fight the comics.
They do that all the time in the comic books. When, you know, the enemy of my enemy is my friend. You know what I mean? That's kind of how it comes up.
And Professor X is always like, I know you're in there, my friend.
You know what I mean? He never gets mad at him. He's never like, you're an asshole.
Right.
He's just like, no, it's okay. Nonviolence. Like,
it's like when those cops come, right? And it's like, he's got a family now. That's cool. And the cops come and like they're like, no metal. All right. Well, what was their plan? Did they have like a whole route of non-metal lined up?
That's what I thought too. I was like, where are you going to bring them?
And that one guy with a bow and arrow.
That makes sense.
And then stab both his daughter and mother and kill him. It's like, I know we have to move the plot along. I get it. But it's just like, ugh.
Yeah, you had to kill both of them. That was the only way it was going to work.
I know.
That's why I told you this is a paint by numbers movie. Everything that you're like, that has to happen.
And it did happen.
But I will say that scene when he takes the locket is awesome. And he kills all those guys with the
it's
locket.
It's like the coin thing kind of first class.
It reminded me of the Guardians of the Galaxy with the little whistle thing. It's just like goes and just everybody just falls over.
Yeah, that was really cool. But I also like the part when Apocalypse shows up at the metal plant or the smelting plant. Yeah. And he's like...
Don't keep me from killing these people. Like, immediately just kills them.
Just kills everybody. Okay, no problem.
Sucks them into the ground.
Sand. He's sand.
He has the power to control matter, Jordan, not just sand.
It's just sand.
Ground made out of sand. That's why I swallow. I'm going to control sand. Gotta be careful with sand. Don't sand on sand.
But
probably glass, too. It's like
glass and sand. All powerful sand. Oh, it's in my eyes. It's so uncomfortable.
His day job is that guy at the car wash who's like, hey, you have some cracks in your front windshield I can take care of. That's his day job.
No, the other thing I don't like is Phoenix. I don't like
That was cool, though.
I thought it was cool, but again, this is the problem. We're gonna do it again.
They're gonna shoehorn Phoenix in again. I like if you want to do the Phoenix, send her into space. Do it like they did.
They're not gonna do
that
far.
Introduce like Gladiator and all those other like awesome like Scott Summers' dad and like all these cool things. Like it would be so much more fun that way to do it like a Guardians of the Galaxy, and then she gets the Phoenix her powers and this and that, instead of like she just has it in her.
I thought Phoenix was something that something she doesn't get till later on.
Yeah, well, I mean, I'm I didn't read all the X-Men comics, but I watched all the cartoons, and that's how it happens in the cartoons. Yeah. And, yeah, it's just more fun that way. And then, cause then Jean Grey was just like a telepath. She was not like super powerful until she became the conduit for the
In these X-Men movies, she was always like, she's a class 9. Remember, like, when Eric
level 9,000.
Yeah, yeah. She's a class 9 mutant. Oh, she's super powerful, even more powerful than either of us. So, like, they've always seen the fact that Jean Grey is one
she's
of
named
the
Marvel
most
Girl.
Powerful.
She's got to be pretty powerful if her name's Marvel Girl.
Yeah,
the
most powerful superheroes out there, and I get that. But the Buster Nut on like Phoenix so early,
I know.
That's but the problem with these movies. I mean, you gotta admit, it was really cool.
It was cool. It was cool to see, and they lay the foundation because he says, "Okay, this was I see it."
Yeah, Apocalypse as he was dying, he's like, "Oh, I see." Yeah,
this is what this is the actual being. This is the real. This is not the false god. Okay, another thing. Speaking of things we didn't enjoy, a lot of stuff is again rushed in this movie. The death of Havoc,
first of all, he's like, "Wreak Havoc." Oh, I'm like, "Oh, it's your name. Yeah. It's Havoc." Oh.
No, but it's just like, he's like, stupid. He's like, "I think I got everybody out." You know what I mean? Like, it's just there's no like impact. Like, he was pretty much a big character. Like,
I
first
all the other movies, dead, though.
Maybe I doubt he's dead. They'll just do another Days of Future Past and take care of all this.
No, I just like
no. He's
like,
dead.
You think he's dead?
Yeah. I think he's dead.
He's doing MacGruber now, man.
MacGyver
or MacGyver.
MacGruber.
No, I just I don't know the way because like back in the back to the TV shows,
yeah.
They don't like he always thinks his brother was dead, but then like he finds him again, and then he's like reunited with his brother,
right?
So I think that's kind of
I enjoyed the okay. So now that we've talked about the things we didn't like, let's talk about the things that we loved or really, really liked. For me, I like the fact that they made Cyclops cool.
Yeah.
They did make
like,
Cyclops
seeing his
cool.
visor at the end, I'm like, oh, that's cool.
He didn't seem like Soldier Boy.
He no, he didn't. Yeah. And he actually kind of played up like, let's get at it. Like, he played the Wolverine part. Right. Which they could do an interesting arc with that particular character to show why he becomes more of the leader. Like, maybe there's a situation where both of the leaders go down and he has to... no one's ready to step up and he steps up.
As long as Mystique isn't there to step up, then that's fine.
Yeah, but I mean... his origin was awesome. I love the idea that he's like, "You winking at my girl?" And he's like, "No, my eyes are burning." Like,
right.
I love that. And I love his, the glasses look cool.
Yeah.
Although I'm like,
they were like Ray-Bans, but with like the shades. It was cool.
Yeah. And I liked the visor at the end. That's probably one of, and he has the band across his chest. Like, he's just, good
the
job.
Ham-fisted him and Gene, though, it's like, yeah, we get it. They fall in love. It's like right off the bat, just all the looks and
I
stuff.
Liked,
you're like,
oh. You know the books getting knocked over that reminded me of the Spider-Man thing.
Yeah,
when she grabs them all, and then she's in his head, and she's like, I can't see, watch where you're going. I can't. Like, I actually thought that interaction was decent. For as ham-fisted it was going to be, I thought they did at least a good enough job. Where he's like, "It's okay, I have glasses on." She's like, "No, they're scared of me, bro. Like, they ain't scared of you." And like the scene with him learning his powers with the tree, my grandfather planted that tree when he was 5 years old. I used to.
I like when he gets in the glasses. Like, let's just look over here in case the glasses don't work. Right.
Like that's why they make Cyclops to be this ultimate, badass, and that's cool. And he's not a soldier boy. And he's interesting.
I mean, his power is super awesome.
Yeah, it is.
I mean, he's super strong.
All he used to do was open his eyes.
That is pretty crazy. That's really good aim, you know what I mean?
Yeah, exactly. And even they show at the fight at the end, you actually see it through his red, like him screaming the optic blast out.
Yeah.
It's very cool. Again, I think that's one of the things that I really enjoyed because I was like, good job. That's a character I normally don't like actively dislike, and I really enjoyed him. Like when Marsden played him, he was playing... the soldier boy jerk,
right.
Jock, gets the girl. Nobody likes him. So that's what I really, really enjoyed. What did you guys like?
I think I liked, and if they do another one with these same characters, I would like to see the whole team together, but like the half the team together. Like, because the team felt very much like the 80s team that we loved growing up.
Yeah.
So seeing them together, seeing Nightcrawler.
Oh, Nightcrawler was
Cyclops,
great.
Nightcrawler was cool.
Seeing all these, your favorite characters looking like they should look, fighting together and stuff. I wish it had Storm on their team. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I'd rather see them all fighting Magneto than really fighting Apocalypse. I don't really care about Apocalypse. And I don't care about Psylocke at all either. But mainly Storm. I wish she was on the regular team.
Yeah.
And she will now. Now we're going to be in the 90s. Oh, the internet. Whoa.
But yeah, when they're in the plane and stuff, I don't know. It just, those were just like so retro.
Oh, we got some flight suits and they all fit and they all look like
X-Men.
Yeah,
but that's fine. It's a movie. I'm not going to, that part I don't really care about. But
it's a logic stuff. But it's like, it's a comic book movie.
But it's cool. You know, the one thing about the team because they kind of have to be careful, because like some of those actors are like, Jennifer Lawrence isn't that old. You know right. what I mean? But she's supposed to be like, well, I remember when you guys... I'm like, you're like 6 years older than these actors. Like, they kind of run into a problem with that because these actors aren't that
they
young.
They should take a break
And the timeline, this started in the 70s, so they're like, it's been how many years since then? Like, 17 years?
Like, Rebecca Romijn Stamos. Like, wow, looking good. If you were born in, like, the 50s, apparently, because she's probably, like, 20... Jennifer Lawrence plays, like, a 20-year-old in the 70s, right? So, like...
Yeah, but I mean, that. Mystique could just be like, eh, that's true. I don't she's feel just, like aging anymore.
That's true. That's, yeah, she's, I suppose.
Peel it back.
She's the one who has an excuse.
Yeah.
But yeah, Nightcrawler was really good.
Amazing. Nightcrawler should be in every movie. Just every movie.
It's fun.
That's another one too, when they threw him in the cage and he doesn't, that's another thing, he doesn't really know. He's kind of learning his powers too.
Yeah. So cool. The end part was great with him trying to flick on and flick off and he couldn't do it. I just love that. I'm Nightcrawler needs to be utilized. He needs to get his own video game, first of all. Like, just a Nightcrawler game. That mechanic of just, like, why not?
Yeah.
And they do such a cool job. Like, I remember there was some video where it was like, every time Nightcrawler does that, it stinks. Everyone was like, oh, God, please stop. What does that black dust smell like? What did you really like about the movie, Joe? Like, one particular thing that stands out in your mind? Or is there anything?
I mean, just overall. Just a solid.
But you gave it a good.
That's a horrible answer.
No, I'm not saying it's a bad movie. I'm just saying overall.
But I'm saying, what did you like? When you think of the that was awesome when that happened. Is there anything in your mind?
The Phoenix thing was really cool.
Seeing Sansa finally get hers.
Yeah. She's fine, John.
Yeah, the whole time. Okay, by the way, I know you don't watch Game of Thrones, but the character, Sophie Turner, she plays a character who's kind of this, she's very, childish and, what would be the word? She never picks up on like all the terrible things that people will end up doing. She's naive, I guess, naive. Is the best young, naive girl. And in this, she kind of plays that same character. She's trying to learn her power. She's young, but then you see the moment of like, oh, unleash it. And I actually like the part when Professor X says, you know why you won't ever win? 'Cause you're alone. And I'm not. Like, that was perfect. That's exactly the whole point of X-Men, is that we will, you know, and the message that he says to everybody, if you're powerful, then protect those that are less powerful than you. Like, those are the moments where I was just like, this is X-Men. This is Professor X. This is Jean Grey. Like, she's walking out and she walks off the steps and just is levitating. Yeah.
Like Chris Angel.
Yeah, you know, it was awesome. Believe.
Actually, the part that kind of stood out was when they brought, when Apocalypse brought Magneto back to Auschwitz.
Yeah.
And was like, kind of taught him, like, given him more powers. Like, no, feel the ground, move the earth. You can feel the metal in the earth. The whole part where he's like doing it all over the planet is kind of dumb. But just in that moment, which was kind of cool. And obviously, I know you don't like the flashbacks of all the other movies during that time.
That one's okay because
that one's the one that bothered me the most, because in the other, they already flashed back to that in the other movie.
Right.
How many times are we flashing back to that?
Gotta keep showing it.
We know.
Yeah, we know. We know. But
that was a cool part in the movie. And
go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to say, why does Apocalypse need four horsemen if he can just change matter?
Yeah.
I don't understand.
But not metal.
He's got stuff to do.
Metal's not metal.
Well, they were saying like it's affecting the magnetic field of the earth, which is more Magneto's department, you know?
Yeah.
He's using that to...
It's always the problem with a big baddie. Yeah, if you go too big and he's like, too powerful, it's like, why doesn't he just make everyone disappear right now?
I hate going back to the negative. I don't know. Maybe you can explain this, but like, they show the global devastation that Magneto is causing all over the planet. Of course, famous landmarks.
Yeah, of course. Got to show
there
this.
There goes Australia,
Sydney,
one of those.
The opera house, I think is what it is.
Yeah, yeah. So there goes landmarks. But like, did anybody die? I'm sure
a lot of people died.
Whole buildings in Egypt are being transformed into sand. To build the pyramid, all this stuff.
There's definitely a lot of people.
Like, Magneto, you did that. If you didn't have problems then, you definitely have problems now, because you killed millions of people.
The bridge that like was getting broken and stuff.
You see
like,
the cars flipping.
I see the cars flipping, but I'm like, but there were no people. Like you could, like there was.
Well, I was waiting for them at the end when the like all the devastation's over. I was waiting for them to be like, wow, all this happened, but no injuries or deaths. Like I was just waiting for that to happen.
No,
like,
I think after the Wolverine scene. Yeah, I was like, okay, they're okay with just blunt killing everybody. Like they're not Marvel MCU. They're okay with just straight up just mowing down people, because you don't see that really in MCU. The stairwell scene in Civil War. You know what I mean? It's throwing guys. You know, they all live, and he even catches them. Don't kill anybody. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And that's fine. I'm okay with that. Like if you want to balance the between kind of the dark and brooding and the popcorn-y, you know.
Here's another inconsistency. Not to just crap all over this movie. It's actually a really good
movie.
It is
a good movie,
like I
said,
there are problems. Easy to do this in like superhero.
You know
movies.
What's good to know? We're not Marvel fanboys, because I honestly like. I wanted to really like this movie, and there are real big problems with it. I think generally, though, like I said, it's good. But go ahead.
Okay. After seeing like early reviews and stuff, I did not have high expectations for this movie, but it was better than I thought. A lot better.
So X2.
Yes.
Wolverine in front of this house, and he gets shot in the head.
Yeah.
And he falls to the ground.
Yeah.
And then the bullet falls out, and he heals, and he stands back up. Okay? In this movie, people are taking machine guns and just tearing him, and he's not even slowed down for
a second.
No,
not even
a second.
No.
He's like Weapon X mode. He's like super animalistic and stuff.
It's that, it's that headset.
Yeah. That's like an old VR.
It's the 80s VR.
I guess that makes more sense.
It's a virtual boy.
It looks bad. It's supposed to look bad. Maybe they pass and they're like, that looks like terrible 80s technology. Like, perfect.
I don't know why. Why didn't they have him in the tube?
They already done that.
Where he breaks out. Ah!
I know.
They did that in the last one.
That's kind of how it works.
I know, but they got to.
So they're like, oh, well, I thought that was canon.
Yeah. Well, see, that's the thing. It all got erased. So all
yeah,
of
the
this,
way he was oh, transformed so his new into origin. Wolverine is different. Yeah, this is his
really?
New origin.
Yeah. That's the part that yeah, and that's why like
what
I said, some
a comic book movie, bro. I don't think
what if
too
it's
much
not
about
animanium
it.
Now. It's just like just some other less
steel, just steel,
stainless,
gold.
It's all rusted. It's copper.
Same cost, you know.
It's copper and it turns
new metal,
turns green like the statue. Yeah,
adamantium.
But yeah, like I said, I think this. If the one thing I will say about this movie, again, not to harp on some of the stuff I didn't enjoy, it seems like. This is one of those, not to hate on your favorite guys, you're both of your Independence Day. A lot
How
more destruction and less like fighting. Like, I want to see them fight.
Yeah.
And it's just like, no, we're going to spend like 20 minutes showing like the bottom
CG
of the ocean.
CG destruction.
Yeah, it's like,
yeah. What was the point of showing that submarine get lifted up? Did it even make it out of the bottom of the ocean? I never saw it.
Oh, is it the boat?
Yeah, just showing all the stuff that he can lift. I mean, it's cool to see the extent of his power, but it's like, I get it. He has, and then, you know, but. One of the other things that I absolutely loved, the Quicksilver scene. I mean, come on.
Of course, yeah. It was the best thing in the movie.
I disagree.
Why?
I think it was shoehorned. I think they did it just because
they're like,
loved
we know
it in the
we
last
loved it.
One.
Yeah, Daisy
and then it was
passed.
Like just saving the people to me was not as cool as like the way he arranged everything in the last one, so all the bullets went to the right places. It was such a cooler scene.
Yeah.
And in this one, he was just saving people, and it was like it wasn't bad. One, and I don't think they picked the right song. I didn't really like the song that went with.
Oh, they went with the Rhythmics. Yeah.
I like that.
Well, it makes sense in the context of what he would be listening to. Now, here's the plot hole. That song would be playing at like 1/100th of that speed, right? Unless he's playing all of his music very, very fast. Yeah, you know what I mean? Wouldn't it?
Yeah.
Technically, right? He'd be.
I mean, I didn't know we were listening to it in his. From
he's
his
got
ears.
Headphones in. That's his whole
well, maybe
thing.
Everything.
Remember, remember in the movie,
that's
he
connected
puts,
to him moves during at his speed.
Well, remember, because I always. And they keep the continuity. Every time
field.
He. Every time he grabs somebody, he puts his hand on the back of their head.
Yeah,
he's
I
like
that.
This
that.
Is going to.
Just snap their neck.
So, I wonder how he figured that out the first one. He's like, hey, I got this cool.
You're dead.
See, the scene I liked with him better than that was when he's fighting Apocalypse. That felt very much like the Hulk Loki thing where he's just kicking his ass.
Yeah.
I liked that a lot. But to me, the other one, it just felt like,
I liked it.
It was all right.
Yeah. And the last battle wasn't that great. It was, like I said, it's just kind of this.
Everyone
it's so,
unite,
it's so,
kill the big bad
it's
guy.
So paint by numbers. I mean, I you know they're going to win, obviously. I do not like how he lost his hair. It's kind of like really.
Yeah, I thought
he looks okay though. You were worried about the way that he looked. I thought he looked okay.
I think it'd be better if like the Oscar Isaac at the beginning of the movie had hair. Then it's like, oh okay, you go bald when you go through the transference.
Oh yeah.
That would make more sense.
Yeah. So that's our spoiler review.
Oh,
wait, you want to? Okay,
that,
hold on.
One more thing.
Okay.
The girl stumbling in at just the moment, and then, oh no, and then like the rug being opened at that time of day. Just happened to let the sunlight in to wake
like
up.
Like they never did
like
that before.
That never happened. Like no one had ever moved the rug at 2.
I know.
Like, it's called plot, Jordan.
I know, but
gotta move
on.
The plot forward.
You know what they need to do?
Something.
I know this is they need to, and I hope they do this. I don't think they have the balls to do it. But put Deadpool in these X-Men movies. Why not?
Well,
or him make reference to all this stuff in his next movie. Be like, remember that time when like the whole world was being destroyed by Apocalypse? Where I should have been helping. You know what I mean? Or something like, you know.
I think they will when Wolverine's not around anymore.
I think
Deadpool is going
to
fill in with Wolverine. Because Wolverine's such a staple.
Yeah.
But he's only got one more movie. Two more movies.
Well,
definitely Wolverine 3 is going to be his last stint as Wolverine.
Yeah,
okay,
so.
the last thing we'll talk about before we wrap up the spoiler part. You wanted to talk about the joke and the non-spoiler.
Oh, yeah, they were walking out of Return of the Jedi, making jokes, funny about Empire. Empire's obviously better. And they were like, it's always true, like, the third movies are always the worst.
And they're
like,
making reference to X3.
Yeah. That's, and itself,
well, and
probably.
Itself, right. This is the third one.
Yeah. Right, and it's the worst out of the three.
And that's what's... I mean, you got to be careful with your joking, right?
I mean, it's true.
Fiction, you know what I mean?
Oh, another good joke in the movie. These three movies really know where to put their F word in this movie. Like,
yeah, they
every
do.
Single time they say it, it's like, it's great.
Oh, yeah. What do they say?
That's when Apocalypse shows up. You know? Who the F are you?
Yeah,
and he's
yeah.
This, they always, like I said, the Bryan Singer does a good job with the X-Men movies. He's never done a bad X-Men movie, I'll say that. Whereas X3 and the Wolverines are, the most recent Wolverine was okay.
Yeah, it was good.
But let's actually get into.
Was that the samurai one?
Hold on, so we're done with spoiler territory. I want to talk about where this fits in and kind of your guys' opinion or just general opinions about the X-Men movies, because there are, you know, 8 of them. So as far as this movie, obviously I think Days of Future Past is probably the best, right?
I agree.
Those two.
Let's just separate these. Okay, yeah. Okay, and then what is the best one of the original three? X2?
The first one.
I like the first one.
I think X2 is better. Nightcrawler, that first scene with Nightcrawler in the president's office is probably one of the coolest superhero scenes in a movie ever.
But just like, I just memories watching the first X-Men movie for the first time being like, this is what a superhero movie is.
Like, yeah, but I remember like Sabretooth not being very cool, and the whole Anna Paquin as Rogue wasn't very cool. And I mean, it was okay.
Yeah, I thought it was cool.
But yeah, I mean, Ian McKellen.
Darth Maul's Toad?
Yeah, that was kind of weird too. But as far as the you didn't like the Wolverine, the samurai one?
No.
The Wolverine, I love
that. I like
Wolverine Origins, it's all great. It's a terrible movie.
Yeah, that's a bad
movie. That is horrible.
But I like the Wolverine. It was good.
That was a horrible ending, that movie, fighting that stupid giant samurai.
Silver Samurai.
Yeah, Silver Samurai.
It was horrible.
He tries power through his bones.
The best part about that, though, was the scene when he has to do the operation on himself. Oh, that was like the most brutal scene. And the same thing happened here, where it was like, these X-Men movies, they don't mind showing you like spliced
cut
open.
The
yeah.
Well,
it's
very
like,
beginning,
oh.
They're like cutting open Oscar Isaac. Sarah's like, oh.
Yeah, that's how I was like, dude, come on. Like, 5 minutes in, we're already.
By the way, we're still talking about spoilers.
Yeah, it's fine. That's fine. Oh, well, it's in the first 5 minutes. So it's fine. It's not really a spoiler. But yeah, so for me, I think this movie fits probably. It's not as good as Days of Future Past. It's not as good as X-Men First Class. And it's not as good as X2. For me, everything else it's better than. So what would sit above this movie for you guys? The first
Days
one,
of Future's Past.
Days of Future Past, would First Class be
first
above?
First Class.
And then X-Men 1?
Yeah. Well, X-Men 1 is my favorite out of all of them. I'm just saying those
no,
are
I'm saying
above
this current
yeah,
movie.
This would be like number 4.
Number 4?
Yeah.
So that's what I'm saying. It kind of fits that middle slot.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it's not good. It's not bad. Now, what's interesting is they talked to Bryan Singer about X-Men 3, Last Stand. And he said, I wish I stuck around and directed it. Because he ended up directing Superman Returns. I think that's... And then Brett Ratner directed X-Men 3. And he's like, yeah, I don't know if I would have killed off everybody.
Right.
And he kind of talks about how if... He said it was rushed, that whole production of that. And it feels like...
Oh, yeah.
This, like, you can't kill everybody. Like, I know it's... And, like, first of all, don't call it The Last Stand. Like,
right.
Like, not a good movie. And that's what I've always thought is interesting about... You know, these movies, obviously they have to give, a movie has to close, but at the same time, it's like, don't close the universe.
Yeah.
And they were joking,
so
I guess
no
on...
No hope. You have no hope that it's going to be any good.
Right, and that's...
Or you're guaranteeing a reboot, which is what happens, so. Which is fine.
Yeah, and so they talked to him, and he's like, it was kind of interesting doing Days of Future Past, because I was like, not just making the movie, but I'm literally like living Days of Future Past, because like... I have to call in the actors to do the scenes that, you know, as their old characters, and like...
That must be cool for him, it's like, I'm writing that movie out.
Yeah, so... I am glad he did all three, I think, of these, right?
He directed First Class, did he?
No, I think he did. I think he did all three. Because it feels similar, all of these movies. I mean, as far as the Michael Fassbender as Magneto is fantastic.
Oh, yeah, he's
like,
great.
I'm hoping he...
James McAvoy is Professor X. It can't be beat Patrick Stewart, but...
That's the problem. You're up against like
the Professor X. Like, born for that role.
Like when they said they were making... Exactly. Like, when they were like, we're making an X-Men movie. I was like, oh, do you want to just... Is he already here? Or
right.
We probably don't even need to call him. He probably just heard, right?
Vaughn directed First Class.
Okay. But again, I think these movies do a better job of... exploring the X-Men universe than even those original movies, personally.
Yeah, I think it does too.
And I think obviously the CGI is caught up so that you, again, you get to see those superpowers in really cool and unique ways. So now that we got through the movies, I wanted to talk about the games. Okay, so what are some of your guys' favorite X-Men?
The arcade games? Game, obviously.
I was just gonna say, hands down, it's the arcade game.
I think
game.
That's the only X-Men
that's
game I've played.
The only great one.
No,
I didn't have a
X-Men Legends.
Legends was good.
Legends was amazing.
What
are you talking about? That was like the top down kind of RPG. Four player.
Like on GameCube, like that era, or was it?
Yeah,
360?
It was around that time. I think it was Xbox. It might have just been regular Xbox. It was a while ago.
It was probably. Yeah,
it was so much fun. You had an RPG, so you'd level up your characters.
I remember that. I think I played a version of that game on the 360. My brother and I.
But yeah, speaking of the Konami beat 'em up game, did you guys ever play the 6-player one? I think it still has the Guinness record of like an arcade cabinet with the most like beat 'em up with the most controllers.
No, I think ours just had 4.
Four is what I remember.
Did you guys ever play as Dazzler?
No.
I think I always play as like Wolverine, Cyclops.
You know what's funny is there's
the staples, you know?
There's a cartoon that is based off of, like before the X-Men cartoon, like that we all loved in the 90s,
yeah.
In the 80s, like late 80s, there was just like an hour long show
called Dazzler.
No, but it has Dazzler in it, and I was like, is that where Dazzler came from? And it's and if you look at it, it's all the same art, and it's definitely like that arcade game was based on this like 1989 one-off 1 hour long X-Men cartoon. So it's a really good, you know, check it
see,
out.
I don't know why they don't so the other X-Men game that's a now they've real quick, they re-released that arcade game on Xbox and I've played it. It's not the same.
No,
gotta be standing
have
up
the joysticks and
gotta be standing up
in quarters
with a stomach full of pizza.
Exactly,
you know,
right? Yeah. Animatronic mouse singing in the background.
The other ones, did you play the Sega ones and stuff?
Absolutely.
Like, those were not good games.
Yeah, they were.
No, they weren't.
Yeah, they were. For the time, they were awesome. You could be a superhero.
I mean,
I remember
cool,
there was a
you
Sega
never could
game.
Do what you want to do.
There was a Sega game. I can't. Correct me. I don't remember the subtitle, but it was X-Men Children of. It wasn't Children of Atom. I know that game. That's the fighting game that was amazing.
Fighting games.
Where you could
fun.
Be Omega Red. Holy crap!
I liked Iceman. Oh, yeah. I'm always Iceman.
I know. The game, I remember when you put it in, it starts you, like, immediately. There's no start. It just starts you with a character randomly. There's, like, 4 or 5 characters, if I remember. But I remember hitting reset, because I always wanted to be, like, one character. I can't remember which one it was. But I would just keep hitting reset until I got that character. And sometimes it would take, like, 8 resets to get cycled into this character. And then you would get to a start screen, and then you could, like, pick your character. But I wanted to always start. Yeah, you're a kid. That crap mattered.
Right.
So I played a lot of the X-Men game. Now, the one that I probably played the most of was the fighting games. X-Men Children of Atom, X-Men versus Street Fighter. Did you play any of those?
Nope.
You didn't play any like the SNK Fighter?
Nope.
Or like Marvel versus
Capcom. Marvel versus Capcom?
Marvel versus Capcom.
Those have X-Men in them.
Yeah, it's not as great as the Marvel or the X-Men arcade game, though. That's like my favorite.
I still think those fighting games are some of the coolest.
Marvel versus Capcom.
Well, Marvel versus Capcom 2 is like still one of the staple fighting games.
Yeah.
I think it's still played in tournaments.
I pumped so many quarters. I probably could have got through college.
I'm not very good at just button mashing.
That's all you had to do. Like, rip, rip, rah. That was Wolverine's thing, right? So yeah, some great video games. I don't understand why there's not more X-Men video games. Like, you know what I mean? I guess now there's a, you
they
know,
had like Wolverine, Animantium Rage or something.
Yeah.
Like
well, the
that.
Wolverine game for the Xbox, I think it was Xbox 360, was really good. It was like brutal too. It had like stealth moments of it too, which was kind of cool. Kind of playing off of his animalistic nature. And it kind of had that God of War, like beat him up comboing. So very, very good. But I think, I don't know if it's maybe a licensing issue where they can't get all of the licensing problems of it.
Well, it's expensive. And then some of those games just don't do well normally. So.
What
harder to take a gamble.
Now, we got to get to the board games. We've got some good X-Men board games. Now, the one that jumps right out of my mind is Legendary, because you get to play. Well, that's got Marvel, but you
it's
know
all
but,
Marvel, right?
Now, there is a game called X-Men Revolution, and it's based off of another, well, it's not a carbon copy, but it's similar to this other game. It's called Spartacus. I forget the name of the subtitle, but in that game, you're like fighting in an arena, you know, like gladiator style, but in the X-Men Revolution, you're fighting in the Danger Room. But it kind
the
of
danger room.
Wait. Yeah, but it's got this kind of ham-fisted approach to, like, you have students and then you have other heroes who come and help you. It's not that great of a game, but the one that I wanted to ask you about, because I've never really delved into it, is HeroClix. Now,
oh yeah,
is it do the because the one thing I've heard about that kind of like the Dice Masters game, the special are there? Does each character have a special ability or no?
Yeah, they have special abilities, but like,
do they make sense context-wise?
Yeah, they do. So like, you'll have like a regeneration ability if you're Wolverine. Mm-hmm. You have like regeneration ability. So like, the idea with HeroClix is as you, if you get hit, you have to turn your little dial, and now you have new stats and new abilities.
Mm-hmm.
So like, if you get to like click 3, Wolverine will have like his regeneration ability, and then if that you have to do something to get to tick off.
Were
and
you
then
the...
you can turn it back the other direction.
Yeah. And then, but how do they do it with like other characters like Iceman and Gambit and stuff like that?
It'd be like you have better movement.
Oh, so you're
whatever.
Quicker and stuff. So yeah. Quicksilver can move around the board quicker,
right,
or maybe make multiple
like moves. Right, exactly.
Okay.
So then they have cards with each character.
Mm-hmm.
So then it'll tell you like, oh, this is this special ability. This is what that means for this character. So you can do different things.
Gotcha. Gotcha.
Like you'd be able to like freeze somebody or something like that.
Gotcha.
Yeah. So
I need to get into it, but it's just the storage of all that stuff. That stuff is going to be
painful. Games, David.
I have all. Yeah, I have tons of them. We should just bring them over. I have a lot. Me and my brother, we just went and we were like adults when we got into it.
That's always
so
the
we
best.
Had like disposable income and the internet.
Exactly.
And we just bought like everything off the internet.
Well, that's the thing. When you buy a couple of them, you're like, we should get the whole team. I mean, we have to, right?
Yeah.
You have to get
them. They're great looking figures. You got to.
Yeah, no, we've got Apocalypse here.
Yeah, they're really cool. And like, is there
a co-op function? Can you play? Can there be like an AI bad guy? Or is it? Is it just
no?
It's
you just have somebody be the bad guy. You could do like 2 versus 1 or 3 versus 1,
and
but
one person's a little bit stronger.
You would need to, because there's a lot of strategy. You want to stay out of range, out of line of sight. Like there's like boards,
miniature combat. Things. Yeah,
yeah, miniature combat. So if you were trying to do it during AI, like how would you decide it to make a good move?
Right.
I mean, I could figure out a way to play by myself, but
of course you could.
It's not intended for that.
Okay. Let's last thing on X-Men, and then we'll talk about maybe some other stuff. What is your guys' favorite X-Men of all time, and why?
Gambit.
Really?
Yeah, I like Gambit from the TV show, the cartoon.
He's
always like smooth talking.
Remy LeBeau.
Yeah. He's always like smooth talking, gets the ladies, you know?
He's got that sick, like, half headscarf, headband thing going on.
Yeah, and the bow staff. Right?
Yeah, the bow staff, and then the kinetic energy power. It's a cool power.
It is.
He does do it with cards, which is cool, but he can do it with anything.
Yeah, right? Where he just, like, grabs bolts and throws them and stuff.
Right? Yeah, it's just a cool power. He's smooth talking, gets the ladies. He's got that cool staff.
His hair
is Cajun.
Cool.
His cool trench coat, his duster.
Yeah, and, like, those weird silver boots. I don't know why he has those weird silver boots.
Are they? Have they confirmed? I know they were talking about.
I think Channing Tatum's still going to do it.
That would be awesome.
I think it's still in development.
The guy who played him in Wolverine was terrible. Origins.
I forget
the guy's name, but I think he was in Deadwood or in the vampire movie.
Well, we were talking about that. That movie's terrible.
No, but I mean, like, it's just again, like, do justice. Gambit is. It's weird because Gambit's in the universe of X-Men. I mean, he's one of the newest characters. I mean, I think he popped up in the 90s. Because the first time I remember seeing him was either the cartoon or the one of the video games back in the...
Yeah, I'm sure he was in the comics before that.
Yeah.
I already know your answer, but go ahead.
Iceman.
I know it's Iceman.
Iceman's the coolest.
Every time we play any game where he's like, can it be Iceman?
Iceman is the best.
This is Halo strongest. Jordan.
I want to be Iceman.
He's level 5, man.
But why? Why Iceman? What?
Level 9,000. Well, first of all, he can make that cool slide thing.
And just go everywhere.
And that is so
I always
cool.
thought that's so unconventional. People are like, God, it's freaking a piece
I
of
just,
ice floating, flying everywhere. What the
I heck? Just remember it, like sixth grade, just sitting in class, being like, God, I wish I could just make an ice bridge to get out of here. Like, this is horrible. Like,
see,
I,
it's...
you guys suck. Bye. I used to read these X-Men novels and stuff, and like they really like delved into Iceman's abilities and stuff. Like, when he was learning, he would freeze, like, the moisture in people's mouths so they couldn't breathe, and then
Jesus
wow that's cool
like, yeah he couldn't because he can control the moisture in the air
yeah in
so
the air.
He could just freeze it in your lungs.
He's not gonna be doing well in Vegas.
That's
dry
true
heat.
That's a dry heat over here, man.
Like, where's the rainforest? I do really well in the rainforest. But yeah, so I don't know, he's just always I love the ability, and then just being, I don't know, it's cool.
It's
how
you know
you
the
not like ice?
No, I don't know, it's
fire guy sucks. Pyro's stupid.
Well, because he can't remember the whole ice. Point was he can't create can't it create. He can only manipulate it. But I will say when
can
in
we
the,
light?
Movie,
anyone got a light? Anyone
in
got
the
light?
Movies when he turned, you know why I think you like it, it's got kind of a there's an Animorph connection here, right? The kid who played an Animorph
no,
TV
but
show.
I loved him way before the Animorph thing, but I do love the Animorph. Or that TV show.
Like Bobby.
Even as Animorph fan,
but when
I
he turns,
so
I think, is it, I forget which X-Men movie it is, but when he goes completely
Days of Future Past.
Days of Future Past.
And, he, so
and like when he gets killed in that, I'm like, Jesus, he gets like cracking in the ice and
so
stuff.
So depressing. I loved that, and I wish they would have given him more time because they just kill him off in the first like 5 minutes of that movie.
Yeah, but toward the climax of the film, he gets a little bit more going on.
Yeah, but I'm saying like, yeah, that's the thing. Like he's kind of a strange character. He fits between that like, you know, top tier Wolverine, Cyclops, you know, as far as like pop culture references, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But he's not a B character either. He does fit that very middle ground of...
I think they made him gay in the comics nowadays.
Yeah, they did.
Not that there's anything wrong with being gay, but I mean, but he had girlfriends and stuff.
But I think that's the whole point is like Jean Grey reads his mind. And then he's like, oh, don't
she's
tell
like,
anybody.
She's like, hey, Scott's my man.
No, but there's this whole thing about...
Stop looking at him like that.
Jesus. I think it has more to do, like, he tells her, like, don't tell anybody. And she's like, no, you need to do it on your own terms. And it's exploring those good, you know, it's interesting. They got to come up with new stuff. They keep going to the same pool of these same stories. They got to keep, no. They
really,
keep,
though? We need to go into the sexuality of the characters?
This day and
care.
Age, you know.
Everything, man. Know.
Coming for our first transgendered superhero.
It'll happen.
No, buck up, sure. Buckaroo. Yeah. Hey, little boy.
But,
yeah, I don't know.
Wow.
Iceman is just the best by far.
What's yours, David?
I know it's an easy one. Wolverine.
Wolverine.
Boo.
I will say the one thing that I liked Wolverine. He was okay in the comic books and in the cartoon because he was kind of a jerk. But the portrayal of him by Hugh Jackman, he's amazing.
Yeah.
Like you see, because in the comics, I mean, not necessarily in the comics, but in the TV show and kind of general like video games, you don't see the brutal like animalistic just.
Well,
straight
they're not
up.
Allowed to. They not, weren't as like that in the books that I read.
No, I know. And that's why at least Hugh Jackman is kind of that first time that in the general bigger audience gets to see like just...
That's what I liked about the Wolverine too is like that's the first one because the other one, in the other X movies, yeah, he's stabbing people and stuff, but it's not really like brutal, but like the Wolverine is the first movie where he's just like going ham on all these people.
And yeah,
awesome.
And like the way he uses his claws in like interesting and unique ways, like, you know, he jumps off a building so he slides down right. And things like that. Like it's... We always joked about, you know, his superpower is he first has to get hurt.
Right. That's the problem. Wolverine has to lose all the time because his power is to heal from getting beat up.
How about you just don't get beat up, buddy? But no, he's got other things. You know, he's got the... He's over there, bub. You know, I always enjoyed kind
always
of...
Always got a fresh cigar.
Yeah.
Handy.
He's just... And apparently he never ages, so good for him.
Yeah.
He's going to be the same... They're just going to have to cryogenically freeze Hugh Jackman to play these parts for the next 40 years.
I mean, he's been playing it for the last,
although
what,
he looks,
15 years, and he looks fantastic.
He does look fantastic.
No it's homo, like, but yeah, he looks... No, no. Definitely looks like Wolverine.
Yeah, so that's mine.
Keep
I know
Iceman
it's...
away from him, you know what I mean? You know what I'm saying?
Oh, jeez.
The other thing is Iceman's cool, because like, I remember him getting hurt. He just refreeze himself. Like, so then he wasn't hurt anymore.
Oh, he could do that?
Yeah, he could.
So he has kind of a regenerative ability. He has to
does.
Get hurt first, though.
But I'm going to use it that
and
often.
In ice form. If he's in human form and
yeah,
gets shot, he's shot.
He's got to be in ice form.
It's true.
Yeah, freeze now. Okay. Anything else you guys want to talk about? We'll wrap it up. I think we've gone long enough, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, let's wrap it up. It's getting late. It's late anyways. Yeah. All right. Again, we have our contest going on right now. It's June for St. Jude. If you donate at least $5 to stjude.org, that puts you into the contest. stjude.org/donate. At least $5, then snap a photo, put it on your Instagram, Twitter, or Facebook with hashtag, you got to do it, hashtag, SDS for Sit Down Standard. Giveaway.
Can I do a quick get off my lawn?
Well, let me finish this. And then you can
it's
get
called
this.
A pound sign.
Oh, God.
I called it one time. They were like, hit pound or hash. I'm like, no. Hash is like hash browns or...
Yeah,
hash. It's called... I know it's a hashtag, but why can't we be like, just pound it out?
You know what's
when
funny?
Did that
pound
happen,
SDS
that
giveaway.
You know what's funny? I had a
stupid
friend that came over to an apartment one time, and I was like, yeah, you got to type in pound, you know, 3367 or something like that. And he's like, where's the LB? I was like, oh, my God.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, I know. Let's not be
but
a
it's
I was like, I hope you didn't tell them. Like, oh, wrong place. Go home.
Go
instead
home.
Of saying hashtag this, they could have said pound out or like pound it. How cool is that?
Yeah.
Pound it, SDS giveaway.
Pound
no,
it.
No, this is cooler. So it's hashtag SDS giveaway, or you could just simply email us a copy of your donation. It's
sitdownstandard@gmail.com.
Again, that email is sitdownstandard@gmail.com, and the contest runs through June. We'll be announcing the winners on July 4th episode. We've got lots of great stuff. We talked about a few today. We want to thank everybody for their awesome donations. We're giving away a bunch of stuff, including a pair of Bose Ultra Sound True headphones, MSRP of $149. And all you have to do
nice.
Is donate $5 at to least. Charity? At Come least. On. And again, it's a couple limitations. You have to be a U.S. continental U.S. resident and one entry per person. So please, please go donate. We want to give all this great stuff away. I'm so excited. It's not even June, man, and we've already got a bunch of donations. So Perfect. Excited. Until next time, bye.
See ya.
Later.